Hey, look down here. Over here, this is John Colin with growingyourgreens.com here at the 2012 Heirloom Expo. And this is going to be another exciting episode. I'm here in the kids area, but we're not going to show you the kids area right now. What we're going to do is we're going to give you a tour of Demeter's Biodynamic Garden, and they're teaching all about biodynamics. So today, you guys are going to get to learn about biodynamics.
Here we are at the garden courtyard area of the Heirloom Expo, and last year what they had here in this area was hundreds of varieties of heirloom plants grown out from Baker Creek seeds, and at the end they had a $2 plant sale. So I guess I'm sad that they're actually not doing that this year and they're not going to have their $2 plant sale, because I got a lot of good plants for a good price. But what I am happy to say is that in this area this year they have a Demeter's Biodynamic Garden, which is going to be a much more amazing and learning experience for you guys out there, and as it was for me. And we're going to take you guys in there for a second for a quick tour and show you guys what biodynamic farming and the principles of biodynamics is all about. And first thing I want to mention is it's called Demeter, and Demeter is the ancient Greek goddess of agriculture. So when you modern people would think of that as Mother Nature. So this is basically farming with Mother Nature instead of against it. So with Mother Nature is using things that are natural and would be happening in nature, and things that are not natural like pesticides and chemicals and chemical fertilizers not used in biodynamic farming. So anyways, let's head inside this area and show you guys what biodynamic farming is all about. We're here at the entrance of Demeter's Biodynamic Garden Lounge, and in this area there's a few things happening. Number one, they have all these amazing displays showing some of the principles of biodynamics. In addition, they have nice signs to teach you about this stuff. But in addition, they have a classroom where they have 7 classes a day, and if you're not here, you're not going to get to see them, talking about biodynamics and how to basically use biodynamics to your advantage to grow healthier crops. In addition, they have a little lounge area where people can meet, converse, and talk, and hang out. Definitely really cool. And finally, they have a little information booth with pamphlets and information that you could take home. But what I first want to talk about is, what is biodynamics? Well, to sum it up in a few short sentences, because, you know, it can get all complex and stuff. Biodynamic farming is basically a comprehensive organic system of farming. And so when you think about biodynamics, you want to think about a closed system, you know, so think of the farm as a complete entity. And one of the things that sums it up really well is this picture right here of like the earth. And on the earth, on this picture of the earth, there's like one farm. And, you know, we're isolated farms, but then we come together as a whole world. So, you know, you don't want to bring a lot of inputs in your farm, and you can grow things sustainably in your space if you set it up properly, and that's what biodynamics is all about. To sum it up, we're going to actually give you guys a quote that's on the bottom of this poster here by Rudolf Steiner, who originally described the system of biodynamics, and I'll read that off for you guys. "Now a farm comes closest to its own essence when it can be conceived of as a kind of independent individuality, a self-contained entity. In reality, every farm ought to aspire to this state of being a self-contained individuality," Rudolf Steiner. So anyways, with that, let's go ahead and tour around this area and show you some of the principles that you should start using in your own home garden. In this first display, what they're displaying is creating biodiversity. You know, not just growing only corn in your garden, but having a wide variety of plants to attract some of the beneficial insects. This is actually a bee and hummingbird garden, and I've seen a couple of hummingbirds as I've been actually sitting here filming for you guys. I would like to grow pineapple sage. That's one of the favorite plants in my garden that the hummingbirds like. It's also a very useful plant. You can eat the flowers and then delicious nectar inside them, and also use the sage for just a herb. But nonetheless, creating biodiversity and about creating ecosystems, very important as one of the principles in biodynamics. We want to encourage the good bugs and basically let the bad bugs come so the good bugs can eat them. And we want the bugs in our garden, but we have to have a balance. If there's bad bugs and you have a healthy balance and good plants, then some of the good bugs will come to eat your bad bugs so that you don't have to spray things like chemical pesticides. In addition, this display talks about living with bees. You know, bees are the pollinators. They're essential in every garden. I would encourage every one of you guys to keep bees if it's possible and legal in your area. They're gonna really help out with pollination and literally just help your garden grow. Let's move on to another one of the displays that talks about the soil fertility, which I'm definitely really big on. One of the tenets of biodynamic farming, and also in my opinion, is simply this: healthy soil creates healthy plants and provided you're eating your plants, it's going to create healthy people too. So we're going to talk about next in this display on how you can build some healthy soil. Now, over all else in your home garden, I encourage you guys to work and build your soil, because without healthy soil, you're not going to have healthy plants. You're going to have disease-ridden plants, bug-ridden plants. It's just not going to grow quite as well. So let's find out how biodynamic farming does it. Two of the ways you can build your soil to build healthier plants, to build healthier people, are cover crops. So by growing some cover crops, they got some examples behind me here, plant them under, that'll rebuild your soil. And in addition, use compost. And that's why I'm super big into using compost and growing in compost. Compost is the heart of the biodynamic system. To use what's produced on the farm, you know, all the hulls, all the extra foliage that's not being utilized, and put it back into the farm to compost that, to bring fertility back into the soil without having to bring external inputs. Now, you know, if I was on a big farm, I'd probably grow biodynamic, but in a small 6,000 square foot residential lot, you gotta kind of do what you can to implement some of these techniques. But once again, at all costs, you wanna build your soil so you can have healthier plants. More on building your soil. One of the things that is unique to biodynamic farming is actually using some preparations. And basically, they make a biodynamic preparations that are used kind of like homeopathic remedies in small amounts to actually rebuild and energize literally your compost and your farm at large. In addition, they like to use flow forms, and flow forms basically energize the water so that it's more in its natural state, so you'll get better production. Another element of biodynamic farming is integrating animals. Animals are integral to the biodynamic farm for their many uses they have. Here we're seeing some heritage chickens. They also have some little baby lambs. And also in biodynamics, they consider animal welfare. So no debeaking, animals have to have free range and all kinds of other good stuff, you know. So definitely integrate some animals into the biodynamics as a very useful resource to have. Next display we're gonna talk about is right here. It's called closed system farming. And biodynamics, very similar to permaculture, looks as your farm or your home garden as a closed system, and you want to keep all the resources and use all the resources you have on site instead of bringing in external inputs whenever possible. So in this display, they're showing a couple things on this half. They got water harvesting, so you know, catching water off your roofs and things like that. They got a worm box. Once again, worm composting or vermiculture is making compost from the worms. It's definitely good shit, if you know what I mean. In addition, on the other side, they're talking about biodynamics and edible food forests. So let's move over to that side of the display next. Another concept of biodynamics is creating like edible food forests and having a diversity of crops and growing a diversity of crops. I mean, in this little area here, we have a raised bed with basils and collards and lettuce. And right here, you're looking at some passion fruits. And then behind in the backstory, we got some fruit trees, including some espalier style fruit trees to grow even more. So besides having a wide variety of things, another tenet of biodynamics is non-GMO and saving your seeds. Very important, you know, input the seeds once, grow the plants you're gonna grow, save your seeds year after year so you don't have to keep buying seeds. Also, the genetics that you're growing are gonna be more and better adapted to your specific growing environment. This is the last display in the biodynamic area that I wanna share with you guys, and actually they've dedicated a fairly large space to it. And what it is, it's about the bees and working with them instead of against them. And actually, it could be pretty much summed up in this one quote right here. It says, "The privilege of being a beekeeper is not to generate as much honey as possible. We keep bees so that we can contribute to pollination. Actually, the future of beekeeping is not in one beekeeper with 60,000 hives. Rather, it's 60,000 people each with one hive. All of them approaching the art and craft of being a keeper of bees as a holistic practice." This is from Simon Buxton, author, The Shamanistic Way of the Bee. So I definitely agree with that. Each one of you guys as farmers out there and growers at home should be keeping bees. And in my opinion, you know, many of things that happen in today's culture, such as beekeeping, is happening for one primary reason, for profits. But, you know, bees aren't in it for the profit. They're in it for the pollination and for themselves. So we need to be able to, you know, utilize the bees, how they can help us, you know, and maybe if they have some extra honey, use their honey, and don't be feeding them sugar water like most of the industry is feeding their bees instead of letting them eat pollen, because they're all being shipped around in trucks to monoculture to monoculture all over the country. So each person should definitely keep some bees. And next, we're going to actually take a look at a couple cool hive designs. So if you guys want to get back to nature, this is how you do it. You could have a log hive. I mean, before there was actual beehives built by man, there was logs that actually just bees just inhabited. So this is kind of taking that and using it to our advantage. This is a standard log, and they drill the little hole right over here as the entrance. And then they've actually hollowed it out, and they have a little door here that hinges up. And you could pull it out, and on the inside here, just totally hollowed out. I wonder what kind of like hand tools or machine did this. Definitely really cool, but this would be the natural way to keep bees and something more akin to nature. But the next kind of hive we're going to talk about here is just a basket hive. This basket hive is unfinished, but I mean, it's just a simple basket with some bracing in here so it doesn't collapse. And I mean, it can be that simple. Next, actually, we're going to look at another cool hive made out of cork. Next, we're looking at a cork hive, and cork is basically like the outside bark of a cork tree. You could actually peel it off, and they have cork floors now, and it's a natural eco floor solution. And you know, we know cork boards, those are really thin cork. Actually, this cork here is about that thick. They just take sections of it and actually roll it, and you can see here they've actually used some string to tie it together, so they put make it just like a little log, literally. I mean, because cork is the outside bark of a tree, and you could see there it's hollow in the inside, and they have a couple holes for entrances and whatnot, and the bees would then make their comb on the inside there. Once again, this simulates more natural, like an empty log. Now we're looking at the last hive they have on display here. Actually, this guy is actually called a sun hive, and this is a more natural hive. It's actually on a platform. This is made out of rye straw, and it looks like maybe some kind of manure that's put together, or some kind of adobe or something like that. And this is all the combs in here, and this is easily removable, so you can kind of see what's going on inside there. Definitely really cool, so you can have access, but this is like gives the bees a natural way to live. All the hives that you just saw here were provided by Gaia Bees right here.
Are you John Kohler?
Yes, I am. Who are you?
I'm Brigham Harpickson.
Brigham, I heard you're my number one biggest fan. Wow, so tell everybody out there in YouTube land, like, you know, how you found me and you know, how my life, how my videos have changed your life.
It has changed my life because I have noticed that I have not been eating so good and that I should have a better diet.
So have you started growing some of your own food because of me?
Yeah.
And has it been one of the best things you've ever done?
Yeah.
And would you tell everybody out there that they should grow their own food?
You should grow your own food because it makes you a lot healthier and it's a lot of fun.
So anyways, as I was saying, we got an interruption there. Yeah, I've been getting stopped by all my viewers here. It's great to meet everybody and to know that I'm truly making a difference, and hopefully you guys are enjoying this video. But nonetheless, to learn more about these different hives, you want to check out Gaia Bees. That's G-A-I-A. bees.com to learn some about some of these different kind of hive styles and hive designs. So, you know, no longer do you have to get that standard beehive box. There's many ways you could do it. Which way's right, which way's wrong, I don't know. Build them all and see which ones the bees inhabit. That's probably the best way. The last area that I want to share with you guys actually in this whole biodynamic garden area is actually the information table. Now, you guys aren't here to pick up the information, but there is a really good website of the organization that put this whole area on. It's demeter-usa.org. That's demeter-usa.org. And online you can find this. This is literally the manual that talks about all the biodynamic farming practices. So if you want to use biodynamic farming practices, you want to check out this PDF, download it, and read it. This will tell you everything you need to know about biodynamic farming. And I want to encourage you guys always to grow naturally and definitely integrate some of the tenets of the biodynamic farming in your own home garden, such as building the soil is very important, keeping bees, using some animals if you can, and also, you know, planting diverse crops and growing a lot of food at the same time. Once again, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and remember, keep on growing.
Keep on growing!